When Samantha was just shy of her fifth birthday, this is the way this book, this last one that I published about 6 months ago, When Did You Ever Become Less by Dying? Incidentally, that's a quote from a wonderful poem by Rumi. This is a real story about a little girl who's just shy of 5 years old who taught me a wonderful lesson and I think speaks to all of us. When Samantha was just shy of her fifth birthday, an age when her delight in every manner of living creature was well underway, she noticed a slug on the sidewalk. This was the same slug she noticed just a few hours earlier, slowly crawling down the front steps of her home. Only now, it was smashed on the sidewalk. "What happened to it?" she asked. "It looks like it got stepped on, Samantha," said her mom. "Why isn't it moving?" Her mom looked at her husband as if handing off the conversation. He said, "Samantha, it's not moving because it died." She slowed her walk toward the house and looked puzzled. Then she looked up at her dad and said, "Will you die, Daddy?" "Yes, Samantha, I will." "Will sister die?" "One day, yes." "Will mommy die?" "Yes." Tears began to fill her eyes. "Will I die?" "Yes, Samantha, one day, a long, long time from now, you will." Now inside the house, Samantha began to cry uncontrollably. When she calmed down just a bit, her dad continued, "Samantha, I know that makes you afraid. That's okay. But why are you so upset? Are you afraid that if you die, you'll miss mommy?" "No." "Are you afraid you'll miss your sister?" "No." "Are you afraid you'll miss daddy?" "No." She shook. She looked up at her dad, eyes swimming with tears, and said, "I'll miss myself." "I'll miss myself." Yeah, and I think she speaks for all of us. At some time or another, we've wondered about what it would be like to be absolutely nothing at all following our death. This talk, the first part of the talk, is why we should take demonic possession seriously. I'll read for about 20 to 25 minutes. We'll open up for discussion, and then we'll get to the second half of the program, which will deal with poltergeists. I place many of my articles, my academic type articles, on academia.edu so anyone can read them. One of them, "The Growing Evidence for Demonic Possession, What Should Psychiatry's Response Be?" stands out. It has had more views, over 12,000, in 4 years than all the other 40-something put together. Clearly, there's an immense interest in the subject, but do demons really exist? And do they target their victims? In a moment, I'll describe for you some of the physical displays that the demonically possessed are capable of. All are vouched for by credible witnesses. All suggest something decidedly superhuman. Conventional materialist theories cannot account for them. Before looking at these feats, though, let me clarify what I mean and don't mean by demonic spirits. I don't mean anything like devils with tails and pitchforks who fell from heaven with Lucifer and have been cursed by God to an eternal life in some cosmic ghetto. That's not what I mean. I mean intelligent beings, insensible to us, with a will of their own, who oppress us and, in advanced cases, possess our bodies outright. Most of them, and possibly all of them, once lived on Earth. Also, let me remove a possible confusion. We should not confuse demons with the far more numerous beings we now call earthbound spirits, and whom Buddhists call hungry ghosts, and Orthodox Jews, dibbuks. These are beings, all with a history of life on Earth, who flee conditions on the other side and navigate Earth without the advantage of a physical body. They gravitate toward people with the same weaknesses they had before their own death. Like parasites, the spirits of men and women who die as drunks, to take but one example, attach themselves to living alcoholics and drink through them, thus making it doubly difficult for drinkers to reform themselves. Earthbound spirits do serious harm, but they are seldom motivated by hatred for the persons whose lives they help ruin. They just want relief from their own pain. But others, the subject of this essay, are clearly malevolent. They delight in destroying lives. They are the serial killers of the afterworld. Often they target specific individuals. They especially delight in bringing about a suicide. Many schizophrenics who hear voices in their heads urging them to destroy themselves will tell you, if you permit them to speak, if you really listen to them, that these voices are alien. They don't come from within, as most psychiatrists think and usually tell them. These voices are the ones we should reserve the word demonic for. So what is the evidence for these dark entities? There are many indicators. Francis McNutt, a leading Catholic figure in the spiritual healing ministry, has seen them all. Quote, a woman may start to speak in a husky voice like a man, or a mild-mannered person may begin speaking in a snide, insulting tone of voice. Often the voice uses the plural we, and on rare occasions speaks a foreign language unknown to the victim. McNutt continues, perhaps the most common external indication of demonization comes when the person's facial expression changes. It is as if you are no longer looking at the same person you started talking to. The old saying, the eyes are the windows of the soul, becomes especially meaningful. It is as if the evil spirit is peering out at you. The eyes become filled with hate, mockery, pride, or whatever the nature of the evil spirit was. Now that the spirit has surfaced, you're no longer directly in touch with the person you have been praying for. End quote. This kind of evidence leaves no doubt in experienced exorcists or healers that they are dealing with an alien spirit. Skeptics, of course, are not convinced. They are likely to scoff at all talk of spirits, especially demons. They require evidence that leaves little doubt. There is evidence aplenty. Here are four examples. A recent case in Gary, Indiana, 5 years ago, featured a boy who, quote, walked backward up a wall and onto the ceiling of a hospital room when his grandmother took his hand and started to pray for him. A horrified registered nurse who was in the room at the time told the Indianapolis Star, there was no way he could have done that naturally. An earlier case from China was witnessed by a room full of persons, including two Taoist monks, one of whom had been called in to exorcise the demon. The other monk recorded what everyone saw. With unutterable horror, we saw that the man's body began to swell visibly. On and on, the dreadful process continued until he became a grotesque balloon of a man. Then, as the exorcist concentrated and commanded the demons to leave the victim, streams of malodorous excreta and effluvia flowed onto the ground in incredible profusion. This process, accompanied by an appalling stench, continued for an hour until the man finally resumed normal size. The anthropologist Felicitas Goodman did field work on a case of possession in a Yucatan village of Mayan peasants in 1985. According to Goodman's report, she tore unripe, bitter bananas from the trees and ate them skins and all, and pulled hot chili peppers from the bushes and stuffed them whole into her mouth. She had enormous strength. She would uproot banana trees 9 feet tall or more, or pick up large chunks of limestone, the building material of the area, and set them into the middle of the street. But the true horror of possession is the suffering and degradation of its victims. In a famous 1975-76 German case, a pious young Catholic, Annalise Michel, seethed with heat, particularly her head. To relieve herself, Goodman reports, she rolled in the coal dust in the basement, filled an old iron kettle with icy water and jumped into that, or stuck her head into the commode in the bathroom. She tore her clothes off and ran around in the house naked. She stuffed flies and spiders into her mouth and chewed on coal or on her urine-soaked panties." End quote. What do we do with all this evidence of apparent spirit oppression? In particular, can it be squared with the materialist worldview of Western psychiatry? Is demonic possession always to be placed within quotation marks, or can we leave them off? Are spirits the hallucinations of a sick brain, or do they have an independent existence? I think that all of you must grant, however grudgingly, that on the surface, the accounts above, keep in mind, there are thousands of similar reports reaching us from all over the world, all cultures, point to a dualist metaphysics. We are one kind of being, and spirits are another. We are visible, and they are not. We are subject to the laws of physics, and they are not. We have physical bodies, and they do not. Yet they are as conscious as we are, as individual as we are, and many of them claim to have lived on Earth before, some even naming themselves. The question before us now is this: how should medical doctors and social scientists adjust their view of possession? Are psychiatrists in this country quietly wondering if there is something to possession? I know that some are. Some are convinced. If so, however, there isn't much evidence of it that I can find in the professional literature. To take but one of many examples, in a psychiatry journal article titled "The Delusion of Possession in Chronically Psychotic Patients," there were frequent references to delusional possession and the delusion of possession in the 25 of 61 psychotic outpatients who believed themselves possessed. It never occurred to the authors that some of those patients might really be possessed. And a few years ago in Newsweek, the lead article, "The Schizophrenic Mind," never mentioned possession, even though the author described schizophrenia as one of the most mysterious of mental illnesses and went on to say that the cause is largely unknown. She and all the doctors whom she quoted assumed without question that the illness was caused exclusively by a disordered brain or chemical imbalance. "In paranoid schizophrenia," she continued, "the patient becomes convinced of beliefs at odds with reality, hears voices that aren't there, or sees images that exist nowhere but in his mind." Since she was supported by every psychiatrist she interviewed, she felt it unnecessary to question this claim. Indeed, it may never have occurred to her to question it. But what is the evidence, after all, that the voices heard by the schizophrenic or the images he sees, quote, exist nowhere but in his mind? This is an assumption, not a fact. It may well be that the voices belong to realities that we cannot see. Does our inability to see them make them unreal? To a certain kind of materialist, yes. But what about the rest of us? More to the point, does the evidence surveyed here point conclusively to materialism? I beg your pardon. Yes. If anything, taken altogether, it points with some force in the opposite direction. There is a telling moment in English author Susan Howitch's novel, Glittering Images, where two of her characters are discussing exorcism. The time is the 1930s. Do they still perform exorcisms in the Church of England? Nowadays, it's generally regarded as a somewhat unsavory superstition. How odd! Is it wise for the church to abandon exorcism to laymen? What laymen? They're called psychoanalysts, she said dryly. Maybe you've heard of them. They have this cute little god called Freud and a very well-paid priesthood, and the faithful go weekly to worship on couches. This character is not speaking tongue-in-cheek, though it's funny. She is saying that materialists who arrogantly dismiss possessing spirits as the ultimate cause of some mental illness are unscientific. The Newsweek article cited above made it appear to millions of readers that the cause of all mental illness is faulty brain chemistry. No discussion needed. I hope I have shown here that this unexamined assumption is unwarranted. I suggest that psychiatrists do the following. Number one, challenge the above assumption with philosophical rigor. Especially consider the possibility that a person might be a mix of two different kinds of reality working in harmony when the person is mentally healthy and in disharmony when not. The invisible part of the mix, some of us call this the soul, should not be assumed to be unreal or a mere epiphenomenon or side effect of brain states just because it is invisible. That reasoning would lead to the assumption that electricity, since invisible, is either unreal or a mere epiphenomenon of the visible light bulb. Who can say that the spiritual component of the person is not like electricity? Surely is it at least possible that the visible brain is the invisible soul's instrument, and that the soul empowers the instrument just as electricity powers up the light bulb? Secondly, psychiatrists should study the responsible literature investigating paranormal phenomena. Over the last 50 years, university professors and medical doctors have produced hundreds of books dealing with deathbed visions, the near-death experience, apparitions, poltergeists, mediumship, reincarnation, instrumental transcommunication, and possession. And several scientific journals investigate these phenomena at great length. Some of the most significant pioneering studies of the human brain, of the human mind, have been written in recent years by university professors or professional parapsychologists with strong academic credentials. Jim Tucker and Erlander Harrelson, both of whom have spoken here in the past, work with little children who have memories of a previous life. And Kenneth Ring demonstrated that blind people who have an NDE, a near-death experience, sometimes see for the first time in their lives. Wow. The conclusions of these three, as well as many other pioneers of consciousness in our quantum age, are the fruit of extremely careful research and should be carefully studied by psychiatrists interested in mapping the human mind. Such study would wean many students from their too hasty materialist assumptions. Thirdly, psychiatrists should conduct research to determine whether the tools and techniques of the exorcist and deliverance minister work better than the drugs and therapies of the psychiatrist. Allow a few battle-tested exorcists and deliverance ministers into mental institutions to work with victims that psychiatry cannot help. If initial results are encouraging, promulgate the findings far and wide. Then write grants for the tens of millions of dollars needed to further test the spiritual techniques that appear to be working. Many trials will be needed and the most sophisticated experiments devised. I predict that by the end of this century, this research will have been done, or at least begun, and that the results will be startling. But why wait for another 50 years? All it takes is for one brave doctor to put his reputation on the line in the interest of truth and compassion and get started. Perhaps 50 years ago from now, Newsweek will do another lead article on the schizophrenic mind. And instead of saying that the paranoid schizophrenic becomes convinced of beliefs at odds with reality, hears voices that aren't there, or sees images that exist nowhere but in his mind, the author will report that, quote, in some cases, it is almost certain that a hostile or mischievous spiritual being causes its victims to hear voices and see images that emanate not from the mind of the victim, but from the mind of the spirit. If that turns out to be the case, then psychiatry will have to turn itself on its head, redesign the curriculum of its medical schools, and get about the business of healing all types of mental illness, those that originate in the chemistry of the brain, those that originate in the soul that constantly interacts with and may negatively alter the chemistry of the brain, and those that originate in a meddlesome or hostile spiritual presence targeting, either with or without its victim's permission, the soul or brain of its victim. Levitation, walking upside down, and other appalling phenomena we've looked at here are part of our world. To deny them is to pretend to engage in self-deception. We know that human beings in physical bodies aren't capable of such feats left to themselves. They get help from another form of being, one that most of us can't see, but who seem very much like us at our worst. They have gone before us into the land of death, but they can penetrate our world and do it harm. The worst of them can terrorize it. Like it or not, demonic spirits, along with their less spectacular and far more numerous brethren, whom we refer to as earthbound spirits, form part of the case for human survival. I wish it were not so, but there we have it. And it does happen to be one of the indicators that we survive bodily death. And that, of course, is what this organization is all about. The word poltergeist literally means, in German, a disorderly, disruptive, or noisy spirit. Geist in German is spirit. Unlike apparitions, poltergeists are seldom seen. You see a ghost, but you see only what this invisible ghost is doing in your home if you're the victim of a poltergeist. The impact they have on their habitat is not only seen, but usually heard as well. You can hear the banging. Some psychical researchers think these disturbances are caused by a mysterious psychic discharge of energy from a living person, almost always someone in the house who resides there. If they are right, then the poltergeist is simply an inexplicable phenomenon, not a spirit or discarnate intelligence, and wouldn't serve as evidence of an afterlife. That wouldn't be of any interest to us. Others, however, including myself, think the disturbances are almost always caused by an unseen intelligence trying to convey a message, usually to the resident or residents of the house. In that case, we can speak of a Geist in the fullest sense of the word, an invisible person-like being motivated to bring about change in the physical world, though without the help of a physical body. They don't have that physical body. The literature provides many instances of what appear to be spirits, and we'll look at one in particular, a famous case reaching us from Cardiff, Wales. We'll go into some depth on this particular case. It's very interesting. We'll even have a little, we'll see. What makes it special is not only the remarkable range of the phenomena, but that the investigator, David Fontana, past president of the Society for Psychical Research, and one of the most renowned parapsychologists in the world in his day, he died in 2010, witnessed the phenomena firsthand himself, and on many occasions over a two-year span, from June 1989 to early 1992. The focus of the activity was a lawnmower repair shop and adjoining garden accessory shop in Cardiff, Wales. The poltergeist took apparent pleasure in the following activities. There were many types of activity. These are 10 of the most prominent. The throwing of coins, bolts, and small stones the size of granite chippings, BBs essentially, many of which were also found to litter the floor when John Matthews, the owner, opened the workshop in the morning, John at that time being the only one with the key, against the walls of the workshop. Okay. All this strange stuff was just mysteriously lying on the floor against the walls of the workshop. Number two, the mysterious arrival of objects termed apor of unknown origin, such as a pen and keys, just dropping out of the sky, out of the ceiling. Number three, old pennies, all dating from 1912, which either appeared to fall from the ceiling or which were found on the work surfaces. Number four, tools on racks set swinging with no apparent cause. Number five, blue flames emerging from a brass shell case which was kept as an ornament in the workshop and which was also sometimes thrown potentially violently around the room, start just flying around the room. Number six, planks of wood apparently too heavy to be thrown by hand, hurled from the yard through the open door of the workshop. Number 7, stones thrown at Pat, John's wife, while she was in the toilet at the back of the workshop with the door locked. Number 8, dust thrown down John's collar and that of a business associate who worked with him. Number 9, loud knocks on the window of the shop when no one was visible outside. Number 10, particularly frequent was the movement of small floats used in the carburetors of the lawnmowers under repair, of which there was a large stock in the workroom. On and on, all kinds of phenomena. These are just some of them. Fontana saw in all these events an intelligence engaged in play. So obvious was this to all involved, 5 respectable middle-aged people with a family or business connection to Matthews, that they gave the poltergeist a name, Pete. Pete especially enjoyed the game of stone throwing. Matthews discovered that if he threw the tiny stones at a corner of the store 20 feet away, stones would immediately fly back and hit the wall behind him. Fontana himself played the game. I tried my own hand at stone throwing. Again, from 20 feet away and aiming into the same corner of the workshop. And to my surprise, a stone was returned, hitting the wall behind me. I tried again with the same result. Over the following days and weeks, John, Pat, and I spent much time in the stone throwing game. Sometimes we got results. Sometimes our stones were ignored. Now, why do you think that would be? Because the spirit wasn't there. Right? That's right. You know, he's not always on call, so to speak. Nothing happened if we threw stones elsewhere in the workshop. It had to be at a specific corner. Only the one corner, which we named the active corner, prompted a response. And so if I start throwing little berries like this out in that direction, what's going to happen? They'll come right back and hit the wall behind me. Imagine such a thing. This was done over and over again by one of the world's leading parapsychologists. Now, stones don't fly through rooms unless they are thrown by someone. We would all agree, right? Still, the repetition of this single act over and over might suggest to the hardcore skeptic some sort of anomaly involving a physical force akin to a magnet. Far more difficult to explain are the following further disturbances. When Pete was asked to bring a certain tool from the workshop into the retail shop, the tool would invariably arrive, seemingly falling from the ceiling and materializing on the way down. Sometimes Pete didn't need to be asked. For example, on unlocking the premises and entering the small kitchen that led off the workshop, John and Pat, John's wife, would sometimes find there had been rudimentary attempts to lay out cutlery on the table as if for breakfast. On other occasions, heavy or dangerous objects were thrown, narrowly missing one of the occupants. It is especially interesting that amid all this throwing of objects, from tiny stones to a steel cylinder, no one was ever hurt. It seemed to all alike that Pete took great care not to harm anyone and had an uncanny knack to ensure it was so. And this is true of poltergeist activity. Rarely is someone ever injured by it, even though potentially there's great danger. As for fraud, Fontana reports, I was extremely fortunate in witnessing so many phenomena myself and in the company of individuals of whose integrity I had plenty of time and opportunity to satisfy myself. The case suggests personal agency in many ways, more than I've mentioned here. But who was the poltergeist? Paul, Pat's brother, saw the apparition of a boy on 3 occasions. Fontana reports that there was a local rumor that a small boy had been killed in a traffic accident immediately nearby some years previously, a claim later vouched for by the boy's elder brother. But there was no way to prove the connection at the time, nor has any arrived since. It's just a possibility. So we cannot say who Pete was or what the motivation for all the activity was. Though, after all, the The activity was often rather boyish, silly games. So it could have been this kid. We just don't know. Nevertheless, it seems indisputable that Pete, whoever Pete was an intelligent, purposeful, though disembodied being. Given that fact, it seems obvious that bodies are not required for personal life. At least physical bodies are not. If not, then what's true for Pete might well be true for us at some future date. When coupled to many other poltergeist outbreaks, the case for survival of bodily death is greatly strengthened. I had the good fortune in the early 1980s to investigate a poltergeist outbreak in Bakersfield. What differentiated it from so many others is that we were able to identify the spirit creating the mischief. I can't go into the extensive detective work I did to come to this conclusion, but all connected to the case agreed that the poltergeist was the previous owner of the house who had died 4.5 years earlier. The house had been vacant since her death. The house, when the new homeowner bought the house, vacant for so many years, and began to make changes, the poltergeist immediately swung into action and remained active for the next 2 months. She regarded the new owner as an intruder and tried to frighten her away and would have succeeded if I hadn't arranged an exorcism. After the exorcism, which was entirely successful, all was quiet and the new owner took the house off the market and stayed in it happily until her death. Poltergeists are part of our world and their motives for the trouble they cause vary. But generally, they are motivated by some kind of resentment or hatred of someone in the house. Let us hope that none of us will become a poltergeist. Incidentally, poltergeist phenomena have been recorded by CCTV, or unmanned surveillance cameras placed in buildings all over the world. You can find sites online which show the activity they cause. If any of you are a materialist, you'll be hard-pressed to fit this activity into your tidy universe. Do a search on CCTV poltergeist and verticalize your worldview.